Yay.
Yay. Okay, we're going to get started. So today we are going to hear from our Executive Director, Jeff Zayach, again. He's going to talk to us about the latest data and also what we're hearing from the modeling from the Colorado School of Public Health. And then we will get another vaccine update from Chris Campbell, our emergency manager. And then we will have time for questions. So I am going to pass it over to Mike, who will let everyone know how we're going to go forward. Thanks for your patience, everyone.
Good afternoon. I am Mike Stratton. I'm with Boulder County Public Health. We will have a Q&A session at the end of our webinar. To ask a question, what you do is you click on the Q&A at the bottom of the screen, type your question in, and we will read that out for you. If you are on the phone and you want to ask a question, you can hit *9. That will raise your hand and we will call on you to read your own question, and hit *6 if you need to unmute yourself. And with that, let me turn it over to Jeff Zayach, Executive Director of Boulder County Public Health. Jeff.
Thank you, Mike, and welcome everybody. I'm going to share my screen and we'll run through some data. Our data is still looking good in Boulder County, so we have good news to share. And we'll want to emphasize the importance of why we want to keep this up. So this first slide is just some summary points. The first two slides are actually just a few summary points. These come from the Colorado School of Public Health. And I wanted to share these because this information was just published this last week. Our reproductive number is less than one. That means our transmission rate is down below one, and it means we are not actively spreading disease, which is why we are seeing case numbers, hospitalizations, and deaths decrease across the state. Our transmission control is actually up from the last projection. It went from 77 to 79%, and that is a good thing. And we'll look at that in more detail on some of the modeling that I'll show you. The infection prevalence is still high, but it's getting better. Our number is 1 in 149 people across the state currently are infectious with the disease. And again, just as a comparison, our numbers in the midsummer were like 1 in 800 people. So we're still at a pretty high prevalence rate and need to keep up our prevention strategies. Time away from home is increasing a little bit, which indicates more mobility. Our hospital, if the hospital demand declines, it could take 2 months or more to reach the summer levels. And that's because as our cases drop, it takes a little while for the hospitals to adjust and for our deaths to adjust. So we should continue to see those declines if we continue to head in the right direction. We'll talk more about that. Wanted to just talk about the importance again here of transmission controls. This comes directly from the Colorado School of Public Health projections. And what I wanted to make sure we're clear on here is just you're going to see again in some of these graphs that transmission control really is going to be the biggest player for if we can control the rapid spread if the variant increases. We'll talk about some of those actual scenarios when we look at the graphs, but it's important to keep our strategies of masking and social distancing in place, especially as things open up a bit more. This is our dial. As you all know, last week we spoke about the dial and the potential changes, and those changes did go into effect as of Saturday at 9 a.m. So we are now in a 7-day incidence rate. I will review some of those changes on a slide that we're gonna get to. But these are our three indicators under phase two of the dial. And you can see that we're in yellow and close to blue for our incidence rate. And our other two indicators are good, although we're at 9 days of declining hospitalizations, and that has gone up a little bit in the last few days. This is the Metro data, and you can see that we've had a sharp decline. This was after, again, the New Year's and Christmas holidays, and we had a sharp decline. We've plateaued a bit here. You can see that there's some slight increases. And we hope that those are short-lived, much like these other ones here were short-lived, but we will keep an eye on that. Our new cases are stable. We're still down below 70 cases. We're at 63.6, a little higher than we were when we reported last week to you. Our positivity continues to remain stable. We've been below 5% ever since the middle of December here, and we are in good shape in terms of positivity rate. We want people to continue to test. I'll emphasize that at the very end. Here's our COVID hospitalizations as of today. We are at 29. Our hospitalizations have come down from a high at the end of November and early December, and have really stabilized here in the 20s, with a little bit of ups and downs, but are pretty stable at this point. So the Dial 2.0 changes, and these are the ones that we discussed last week. All of these did go into place, as I mentioned, as of Saturday at 9 a.m. So we are now on a 7-day metric instead of a 14-day metric. So just as a reminder what that does, our 14-day metric was pretty much double our 7-day metric. So it moves us down in the dial. That's why we've moved to orange, from orange to yellow, effective on Saturday. The other thing the dial does is it does not allow the 5-star business program to operate in blue until after 70% of the Coloradans age 70 and older have received at least one dose at a statewide level. So that is a statewide number, not a county number. That number has to be achieved at the statewide level in order for the 5-star program to operate in blue. We can also move more swiftly between levels. The governor's office and CDPHE has made it really clear that they will not require mitigation plans. Typically, in the old dial, we would have to submit a mitigation plan. We would have up to 2 weeks to do that. And then we would have 2 additional weeks to see if the mitigation plan was making a difference in the numbers. What CDPHE and the governor's office has committed to is that they will move counties without mitigation plans. They will just move counties as they move into the new dial metrics. And then they have made it clear that they expect to make a couple other changes, and that will depend on what vaccine looks like as it gets more and more into our community. One of the main reasons that there is vaccines getting out to our 70 plus age group, that's our highest risk age group. As vaccines continue to get out into the community, they have already mentioned that Dial 3.0 and 4.0 would likely also have changes to it. So we don't know what those will look like, and we don't know the exact timing, but we will let you know as we learn new information. Let me get rid of this. This is the graph that I was mentioning to you, the projections that the Colorado School of Public Health has been working on. What I'm going to focus on here is first this top graph, and this is the total number of infections. And what I want you to look at is the dotted lines. You can forget the solid lines for now, because that is a scenario that does not include the variant spreading, but we do have the variant here. So I'm just gonna focus on the dotted lines. Again, this is total number of infections. You can see on the bottom that there is different scenarios. There's a 79% in transmission control, which is where we are now. And then there's two other projected scenarios. The blue scenario where it's a 70% transmission control, and a worst case scenario where it's a 60% transmission control. And the key message here is for the hospital graphs below. In the worst case scenario, we are not exceeding our ICU capacity, and we are not exceeding our total hospital capacity in the state. If you look at the top graph in that 60% scenario, this is again the worst case of the three scenarios they're looking at. In a worst case scenario, we would be at just over 4,000 active infections in the state. And this compared to some of our worst time in this outbreak, which was in November and December, was we were at a max of 7,000 in terms of active infections in Colorado or active new cases in Colorado. So the projections are lower than the initial cases that we saw in November and December. I really want to emphasize again here that transmission control is going to be what is really controlling the outbreak of this disease. These three scenarios take these assumptions into play, that vaccination is assumed to continue at the current rate, that the variant increases at 1% per day until it is 50% of our total infections in early March. So there is some assumptions in here. What the Colorado School of Public Health will do is they will rerun these projections each week, and we will be able to look at them each week. The governor has been using these projections along with advice from his senior leadership team to make decisions on the dial itself. So these are important projections as it relates to how we move forward. I wanna just emphasize again, I've showed this graph in the past, how much masks make a significant difference. So when I talked about maintaining good transmission control, the reason that we're doing well in Colorado compared to other states, one of the reasons, is that we have about a 75% masking rate in Colorado, whereas the average of states across the US are around 50%. And you can see here that this purple line, this is the projections for daily infections. This is the projections for daily deaths. This is universal mask use, this purple line. And the blue line, it's a little bit hard to see here and a little bit hard to see here, is rapid rollout of vaccines to high risk. So masks, especially till vaccines are widely available in our community, are going to make a big difference in helping control the disease and keep our transmission control high in Colorado. All right, and then this is the last slide. Just wanted to thank everybody who's been taking this seriously. Following the prevention strategies are going to help us be able to open up a little bit more and control the amount of disease that gets spread. So using masks, washing your hands, keeping at least 6 feet apart, those are really important steps to take as things open up a little bit more here in Colorado. We also want people to get tested. Testing in Boulder County is free. We've got multiple test sites. If you just go to Boulder County COVID-19 and you click on the testing link, it will take you to the sites, what the hours are, whether they're free or not. And they're very easy to access. Turnaround time for tests has been really great, usually 3 days or less. So it's easy. You don't have to have symptoms. The Colorado Department of Public Health and Environment has committed to continuing to support the testing sites, especially as the vaccine is continuing to get out into our community. And we want to be looking for the variant as well in Colorado. So testing will continue to be important as we move through these next several months. Please take advantage of it. Again, it's free. And there is hope. Vaccines are being distributed, as you all know. I know it's been confusing and challenging to find information on that. We're going to talk some more about that here. And at this point, I will turn it over to Chris Campbell, and he can share more about where we are with vaccines.
Okay, thanks so much. Good afternoon, everyone. It's always a privilege to be able to connect with community members through this forum. Thanks so much for joining us. My name is Chris Campbell, and I'm the emergency manager with Boulder County Public Health and working with incredible teams to provide vaccine to Boulder County community members. I'm gonna provide an update building on what we provided last week to our vaccine administration. Let me go ahead and share my presentation. Okay. And I just want to provide an update for the community members generally where we're at with vaccines being allocated in Boulder County. We are making progress on those second doses, which are very exciting. Again, it's steady progress. So we on that first dose with community members, we've given them 17,000, nearly 18,000 vaccines. That important course, getting that second course and second doses available in, to community members is 15,000. And a total community members that have been able to get at least one dose of vaccine is at 32,000, nearly 33,000 community members in Boulder County. Just a reminder, and we provided a significant update last week. There has been recent updates to the statewide phasing plan, as many community members know. I just want to reiterate and be fully transparent with the community that this is something that is done at the statewide level at the governor's office, and they really are driving what this phasing is looking like, and we're working with it. And so I'll give some updates there just to remind community members that phase 1A was one where we started out initially, and these are healthcare workers in that highest risk setting. We are excited that we're nearly through that group. There are some community members, just some one-offs that we know we need to continue to work with, and we are vaccinating them. Additionally, we also know through the National Pharmacy Partnership that our residents working and living in long-term care facilities, skilled nursing facilities, assisted living, have been vaccinated. Many of those have had their first doses and second doses, and we've made great progress there. So it's very good news. Additionally, we are then moving in and have moved into that phase 1B1 as well. We have been working through that, and I'll show some data on the amount of community members 70 plus that we've been able to vaccinate. But we still have a group of folks that Boulder Community Health actually is doing clinics for over the next several weeks, about 3,000 community members that fall in that 1B1 category. These are moderate risk healthcare workers. So we are working through and diligently vaccinating those community members. We really appreciate patience with that group, and you'll definitely be hearing from us very soon. As many of you know, then we've, as of the 8th, so Monday of this week, there was an additional phase added, 1B2, and these are community members in Boulder County that are 65 to 69, along with our early childhood care providers, our school districts, both the public school districts and private school districts in Boulder County. So community members became eligible to be vaccinated. I saw some messages from community members that might be part of these groups, just because it really you were eligible to be vaccinated starting as early as this Monday. We are still also working through these other groups as well. So, the message, I know it's a challenging one. The message is still patience. We know you're there. We know that you have gone to our website and signed up with providers in the community, and you will be notified when vaccine is available to you. So we have vaccinated about 60% of community members are 70 plus. We definitely have some work to do there as well, but I think that is a very good number. We know likely by the end of this week, that's gonna be closer to 70% of community members. So we are diligently working through that group and also working again, as we work through that group with other community members, 65 to 69. Additionally, our educators in the community. Just to again reiterate some numbers, so everyone understands, when we added those community members 65 plus, we added about 17,400 additional community members in Boulder County. So, again, it's a challenging message, and we recognize that patience is what we need right now. We are diligently moving through these groups. I will say that our vaccine allocations are becoming a little more consistent in Boulder County, still not where we need them. But just the week prior, we had about 7,000 vaccines allocated to Boulder County. And this week we had about 8,000 vaccines allocated to Boulder County. So progress and patience. Just so community members understand, we worked with all the early childhood providers in the community. We worked with the school district, St. Vrain Valley and Boulder Valley School District, and the early childhood providers in the county, and we matched them with providers. So I can't thank again our providers enough for stepping up and really working to start to vaccinate this group. So they're working on that group separately. Again, if you're an educator, an early childhood educator, please work with your school district, with your agency to access vaccine. As we mentioned previously, so we very much are focused on our equity strategies and have made progress there. My update really is going to focus today on some issues we've seen, and we mentioned this around vaccine education. And we want to ensure that community members have the information they need to make informed decisions about getting vaccinated. So that is a big part of our equity strategy. We are implementing community-based clinics, and you'll hear more about that in the next several weeks in our updates. And we're also implementing what are called mobile clinics. And these are smaller clinics focused on, right now, independent living communities and those that are homebound. We know that there's barriers to accessing vaccine there. So these two strategies, I have made progress even since last week, since we gave you the update. And we're continuing to work through this. What we do know is, we know that racial and ethnic minorities, in the community are definitely have seen barriers and historic barriers. Community members that have been impacted by systemic injustice are a challenge as well. So we are very cognizant of that and want to continue to work with community members on this to ensure equitable access to vaccine in Boulder County. So I will just, the big focus of the presentation today is this trust in vaccine and really education again to make informed decisions about accessing vaccine. We know that hesitancy or lack of enough information for community members to make informed decisions will potentially impact our equity goals in fair and equitable access to vaccine. So I'm going to touch on that in the next slides here. And as I mentioned, we are creating the infrastructure to bring vaccine to community members in trusted places. These will be places potentially like schools, school locations, or potentially churches in the community, potentially areas in the community that are really trusted by community members. I wanted to share, this is some results that were provided by the State Health Department, CDPHE. So they did a survey, and this was actually before vaccines were authorized. So they did a survey, and they surveyed about 811 Coloradoans, and they wanted to understand community members' concerns, Colorado's concerns about the vaccines. And I wanted to share some of that data for you all and information. One really important point that came out of that and one we're gonna really focus on, and you'll hear more from us in the next couple of weeks, is the willingness to be vaccinated among race, ethnicity, and gender is a challenge in the community. So I did want to share this graphic with you. We are really concerned, as you see here, women in the community potentially have concerns about accessing vaccine. So we recognize that, and what we're going to do is really work on that vaccine education component. And we'll share a little bit about that here. And actually, Dr. Urbina is going to share some information on that shortly. So some of the motivators that the survey got out about of why folks would be interested in getting vaccinated was to protect themselves or their family and really to really see an end potentially to the pandemic. What we saw in the survey for reasons why folks might not want to access vaccine, they were concerned about how the process of the vaccine was went through to receive emergency use authorization. So maybe not tested enough. Some folks are concerned about side effects of the vaccine and long-term effects. So those are some of the things that really came out as important points why folks might not want to get vaccinated. The top message, really what you're going to hear, we really will ask community members that have joined today to share, is, you know, vaccines must be proven safe and effective before they're given to community members. And we know that these COVID vaccines are no different. They went through a rigorous process, and they have proven to be safe and effective. So just another interesting point from this survey that we wanted to share with community members. We know that most Coloradoans really trust healthcare providers, doctors, nurses. They also really trust scientists and researchers to provide very clear and valid information, along with the state health department. So what you will see, and we're partnering with the state health department on campaigns to provide information in many languages to really provide that information for folks to make informed decisions about being vaccinated. So more information to come on this. I just wanted to share some of that data from that survey from the state health department, and you know, just set the stage for more of these community forums to come. We definitely would remind folks to go to our website to access this information. Additionally, you should see on social media and other forums, some community forums will hold to provide information and education about these vaccines. And I would like to turn over to Dr. Urbina now just to follow up a little bit on that vaccine education message.
Yes, thank you, Chris. I just wanted to compliment you and the team for doing such a tremendous job of working with our vaccine partners in our community. That's a critical aspect as we move forward, because we know that many of the community members would prefer to go to trusted sites like a Salud or a Clinica or a community setting where they can actually get the vaccine from their providers. So we're working with those providers, BCH, UC Health, and all of our other providers, Kaiser, our local pharmacies, is critical for us to reach to those communities. And I also appreciate the fact that you're looking at very carefully targeted clinics, clinics out in the community, working with trusted partners. I think our communications team, Mike and Chana and Angela, have all done an excellent job of doing outreach in languages that are appropriate, particularly Spanish. We have Spanish translators on this forum, but we're trying to put that information into communities, working with trusted partners as well. And Elizabeth Mendoza and Dr. Sheila Davis are also working with other trusted partners in our community to do community forums such as this at a local level, which I think are also critical in developing that trust. Not everybody accesses the internet. For many people, particularly the elderly, the internet is a big challenge for them. My dad, who's 93, I had to help him get his vaccine. and he's a Mexican-American gentleman. It was hard for him because he has a phone, but he doesn't have access to the internet. So I think we need to reach people where they are and have a conversation about how what their issues are regarding vaccine hesitancy. So I think Boulder County, through our health department and through our community partners, are doing an excellent job of trying to do that. So I think you're going to see more information from our team, as well as if you are part of that community, we'd encourage you to spread this information, the phone numbers, the websites, and participate in future community forums so that we can spread the information and not the infection. I think as people get knowledge, I think particularly from people they trust, they will accept the vaccine. And in the meantime, I also wanted to throw out something that Jeff Zayach said a little bit earlier. The fact is, vaccines are only a part of our solution to decrease community infection with the COVID virus. We still have to continue to use masks. We still have to engage in physical distancing. We have to be washing our hands and avoid large groups as we vaccinate our community. So if you're part of those groups that are now being phased in, I want to reassure you, you're going to get your vaccine. But in the meantime, you should be continuing to use those prevention mitigation strategies that we've talked about, both Chris Campbell has talked about, as well as Jeff Zayach, our director, have talked about. So I'm going to stop there, Campbell, if that's okay with you, unless there's anything else you wanted me to address, and then we'll open it up for questions. Maybe I'll turn it back to Mike or Chana to see if there's anything that we needed to say from here.
Thank you, Dr. Urbina. Yes, we are now at our Q&A time. Let me tell you how that works. At the bottom of the screen, if you're on the web, that says Q&A, click on that, type your question in, and we will read that out for you. If you are on the phone, you can hit *9 on your phone. That will raise your hand. We will call on you and you can ask your own question. You may need to hit *6 to unmute yourself. We will get to as many questions as we can today. We ask that you keep your questions short and succinct so we can do that. All of our panelists are approaching this from a place of respect, and we ask that you do as well. Now, along with the panelists that you've heard from already today, we have Kate Haywood on deck. She's with the Boulder County Attorney's Office. And lastly, if you have questions that don't get answered, if something comes up later, you can send them to in an email to healthinfo@bouldercounty.org. All right, so let's get to some of the questions. Chris Campbell, this one's for you. I know we've heard this kind of thing a bit. The question is, I heard there are signups for surplus vaccine doses from providers at the end of the day for those who can arrive within a short time of the vaccine location. Is this true? And if so, how do we sign up to be notified?
That is a great question. I think I have discussed this before. So each of our providers have a bit of a different process for this. What I do know is you need to be eligible under the phased plan to be considered for these for this backup list. What I would recommend is a phone call potentially to the provider to be on that potential backup list. And again, you do need to be eligible for vaccine. I would also say that, and just a reminder for community members, we know that vaccine is not being wasted in the community. I think our providers have done a very good job of honing their processes for bringing folks in at the end of the day if vaccine is available. It's usually not all that much vaccine. It's usually just a few doses, but it is something you could potentially access.
Hey, thanks, Chris. This next question might be for you, it might be for Dr. Urbina. Why should I get a COVID test if I don't have symptoms?
Campbell, I'd be happy to answer that if you're okay with that. We know that 40 to 50% of all infections are asymptomatic, particularly among younger people. So that if you've been exposed, or you have concerns about that you come in contact with somebody who has the infection, or you're concerned about either travel, or you're working with your mother or father who's in a high risk group, the testing is free and we have lots of sites in Boulder County. I would encourage you to get that test. It does because many of the cases are asymptomatic. What that does is if you are positive and you are carrying the virus, we can isolate you and contact people that you come in contact with to put them in quarantine. What that does is it eliminates the virus in our community. I know that sounds scary, and I don't mean to say that we're going to put you in jail. What that means is we want to move you away, and if you have knowledge that you're infectious, we don't want you connecting with other people. And that's why we always say wear a mask, wash your hands, and avoid large crowds, because we don't know who's infected. If you get tested and we know you're infected, you can be safe and help protect others.
Thank you, Dr. Urbina. Chris Campbell, this one is for you. First question is, what percent of Coloradoans age 70 plus have gotten their vaccine, first vaccine dose, second vaccine dose? I know you said 60% have received their first vaccine dose. The follow-up to this is, will we have numbers for these other age groups, 65 plus, et cetera, as we go through the phases? How are we going to track that?
Thanks, Mike. Great questions. This is being tracked at the state level for statewide data, and we will continue to provide transparency with our data and how many community members have been vaccinated in Boulder County. Perhaps we can share in the chat the link to the state CDPHE website for some of this data. There is that data there, statewide data, both on with an equity lens and how we're doing with priority populations in our communities, along with data about statewide about how many folks have been vaccinated. So that will be on that statewide website, and we'll continue to provide that data locally for Boulder County.
Thank you, Chris. I'm going to throw another one your way here. Question is, should community members sign up for all providers or be selective? If we sign up for all, would this contribute to a free-for-all? How is the best way to approach that?
Another great question. Thank you for those questions. Again, it's not an ideal system right now. What we have recommended is, if you already have an existing relationship with the provider, say you already go to Boulder Community Health, we recommend you sign up there first. However, it's good to expand your options. We have all the providers on our website. You're welcome to work with them and sign up. Again, it's just depending on that vaccine allocation for that particular provider, that's when your opportunity will come up. So again, not ideal system, but we do recommend that you explore your options and continue to check in. I will say, I know we had some questions from community members that are 65 in that group. Likely you're not gonna have access to vaccine this first week. We're continuing to focus on 70 plus year olds with our providers. But you, again, will not be skipped. You will have an opportunity to get vaccinated. So please continue to check those provider websites and communicate with them.
Thank you, Chris. Most of these questions are about vaccines, so I'm going to stick you on the hot seat once more here. Excuse me. Do the current providers have the capability to manage the cold storage that's needed for both Pfizer and Moderna? Do they have specific needles in order to get the maximum doses out of each vial? Could you talk about that, please?
That's a great question. Absolutely, the answer is yes. I think mostly you'll see our hospital providers mostly have the Pfizer vaccine because they have the ability to handle those vaccines. Boulder County Public Health, for example, we only are offering the Moderna vaccine. It's just because of storage for us and handling. So absolutely, our providers have been really skilled at this, and vaccine is allocated to them, based on their ability to handle the vaccine. It's been incredible to watch how quickly all our providers have quickly understood how to handle the vaccine, most effectively use it, most effectively look at those additional doses that could come out. So supplies are definitely being provided to maximize the vaccine. No dose is being wasted in Boulder County, and we have been able, it does depend on just the lot that's shipped to the community from the providers, directly from the distributors. Some of the vials we see do have some additional doses, some don't.
Thanks, Chris. Dr. Urbina, here's one for you. Is there a time after you've received the vaccine when a COVID test would show positive?
Thank you for asking that question. That helps us get to the root of understanding how this infection is transmitted. This virus is transmitted through respiratory droplets and through aerosolization. And that's why the mitigation strategies that we talk about are actually very helpful. If you get a test, the PCR test, the nasal swab that people talk about, or the antigen test tests for those proteins that are around the virus as it's transmitted. The PCR test tests for the nucleic acid of that of the virus if you're infected. There is an antibody test. It's not a very good test for the for show infection. So that's why we recommend the antigen test or the PCR tests. The free PCR tests that we offer in Boulder County are the PCR tests that test for nucleic acid. I know this is important for you to understand, is that the vaccine doesn't give you the infection. It stimulates your body's response to that spike protein that we talk about, those little red dots in the picture that you see in the media and the newspaper and the, on the website. That produces antibodies. It mounts a immune system protection against future infections if you come in contact with the virus itself. It doesn't give you the infection. So the PCR test will not be helpful. Neither will the antigen test be helpful. So neither of those tests, because those tests test for the protein as well as the virus, but not for the but not for after you've been vaccinated. The only test you could potentially get would be the antibody test. And because the antibody test is not very accurate, we don't recommend you get that test after you get the vaccine. So don't even think about it. Get the vaccine, be assured that it's going to be highly effective and safe, and don't even worry about getting tested after you get the vaccine.
Thank you, Dr. Urbino. Jeff, I believe this one is probably for you. It says, how should we as community members try to reconcile the recent warning by Dr. W, the new CDC director, that this is not the time to relax restrictions when the dial has actually been turned back? We're now at yellow. We have different metrics to meet to stay in the different dial phases, and also with the return of CU students this week.
Thank you for that question. A couple things to remember. The first one is Colorado, I think, is seventh now, the seventh best state in the entire nation in terms of overall COVID burden. We are doing very well in Colorado, much better than most other states across the nation. As I had talked about in the slides, the projections that are being run from the Colorado School of Public Health are not projecting that we are going to exceed any of those challenging situations where we have to worry about hospitalizations or ICU capacity. It does mean, as you can see, that there would be a little bit more cases in our community, but that is dependent upon that transmission control and those strategies that you heard me talk about, you heard Dr. Urbino talk about. So as we do open up a little bit more, and we have started to open it up a little bit more, making sure we're masking and not letting down our guard there, and making sure we're social distancing. Those are things that throughout this entire disease progression, we've continued to emphasize, because they can slow and stop the spread of the disease. So that's just going to be really important as we move forward. And it's going to be key. You saw in those slides that the better we do that, the more we hold this down, and we can continue to open up a little bit, but it's all up to us. And I just want to encourage people and thank them for what they've done so far to get us here.
Thank you, Jeff. Chris, here's one about vaccine distribution. Are there plans to give vaccine supplies to the county health department in addition to the major health care systems?
That's already happening. So Boulder County Public Health has been doing vaccine clinics on a smaller scale for really since the start of the vaccine campaign in December. But we have scaled up. We've been holding a regular Tuesday clinic where we've been doing about 450 community members. This Thursday, actually, we're going to look to do a vaccine clinic between 850 and 1,000 community members. So we are definitely a provider. Likely we'll see from us is a big focus less on these clinics. What we're trying to do right now is again get through some of the moderate risk healthcare providers that are on that 1B1 list, And what we will likely shift to as a public health agency is this equity focus to ensure vaccines are getting to community members where they're at. So you'll likely see that from Boulder County Public Health. And the hospitals have provided wonderful vaccine clinics, and those are going to continue.
Thank you, Chris. Dr. Urbina, this is probably for you. Are there any at-home tests available in Boulder County for COVID test? Can you give us any specifics or how to find out that information?
So I'm going to partially answer that. I'll ask Campbell to also weigh in on this one. There are tests available. The Binax now is a test that is available through some school systems. Not all of them have that. But also you can mail in. There are several that you can mail in and try to get those tests online if you'd like. I would just go to the CDC website or to the CDPHE website to find out about those availability. But we currently are recommending the PCR test because it's freely available at several sites in the county. And many providers also have the antigen or point of care test that's quick and easy to do. So Campbell, are you aware of any other home tests available in the community?
I would just reiterate the need for education. There is just a wide range of tests available. So go to trusted sources like, again, the State Health Department's website to really vet those tests. There are good tests available that are at home. They have some costs associated with them. So what we would say is, please access our free testing in the county. We have significant capacity, and it is very much improved with turnaround times and just accessing that testing. So lots of options, but again, I would just encourage community members to take the time to do some research.
Thank you, Chris and Chris. All right, Mr. Campbell, here's another one for you. Can you tell us about the next age group to be vaccinated? I don't believe it's actually an age group, but can you tell us how the next few phases will run?
Another great question. Thank you. What we're looking at in phase 1B3 is a larger group of frontline essential workers. And we haven't heard much information about that, full transparency for community members. So we're seeking some guidance and information about some large categories like frontline essential workers in manufacturing, for example. That's a very large group. So we hope to have that this week or next week. It does, according to the governor's office and the statewide plan, it does shift to those types of workers and doesn't really move away from the age groups.
Okay, thank you, Chris. I've got a rather long one I'm going to try to shorten up a bit. Is there any thought about requiring prescriptions, et cetera, when we get to the 1B3, because there's that two health conditions that will be up next in that phase? Do we know how we're going to identify folks for that group?
Yeah, that's a wonderful question. I would say, we're going to err on the side of vaccinating as many community members as possible, knowing that the vast majority of community members are going to be honest. Likely what you'll see is just some questions from providers saying, do you have these underlying health conditions? And then you'll be able to be vaccinated. So, it's a challenging one, for providers. And I think we'll continue to move through it well. I think, again, it's that we're not going to, we always err on the side of trust and vaccinating as many people as possible. So again, I think what you'll probably see is just some questions from the provider about your conditions and then you're eligible to get vaccinated.
Thank you, Chris. And it looks like we are out of time. If you had a question that didn't get answered or something else has come up, please send us an email at healthinfo@bouldercounty.org. And I believe that's it. We will see.
I'll wrap it up.
Oh, will you wrap it up? All right, Chana. Yep.
I just wanted to say a good evening to everyone, or a good afternoon to everyone. And just a note, you know, we hear over and over, we're all in this together. And the truth is we really are. And when we talk about vaccines, we really are. It takes all of us to get vaccinated and help others in our community get the vaccination they need for our community to be able to move on and for our businesses to open and our kids to be back in school. So I'm grateful for all of you for everything that you're continuing to do. Hang in there. You will get a call for a vaccine. Believe me. And we look forward to seeing you next week. Thank you.